some announcements. So we have a midterm in the same hall, like in the same room. Okay. So it's on Friday, October 20th, from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. And it's in the same room. Okay. And so the questions on the midterm, the type of questions, you can assume them to be mostly to be like the things that you see on the worksheets. Okay. And there will also be like some short answers, like you saw in the first or the second worksheet, where you are expected to write something. Those things would be like some very simple short answers, or like some reasoning type of questions. Okay, why is this, why is something like this? Why are we doing something like this and stuff like that? And you can also definitely expect like the problem-based questions, so, as you see in the worksheets. And other than that, so you can expect like at least one question from each topic, as you would have seen in the previous midterms that we shared with you. It mostly is like very similar. Like there will be at least like one question from each topic, and so no cheat sheet is allowed. We just want to make the exam like as simple or as easy as possible. But if we allow cheat sheet, then we have to make the exam like more complicated or like more difficult, which we don't want to. That is the reason why we are not allowing cheat sheet. And again, don't worry too much about we will definitely not be testing something like can you write down this all the step of events that are happening on in a limited direct execution protocol or something like that. We are not going to ask questions like that, completely based on your memory. But we will be like, we are showing you, okay, I'm just telling all these things because most of the questions are already set, okay? And so if possible, you can just ask some questions and try to extract some meta information about the exam. And so it will be more like, okay, if, so, not going to give some details, but let's assume if we five things happen when a system call happens. Let's assume these are the things that happen. Okay, there may be just one thing that is missing. Can you like fill that out? Something like that. This may be like one question, stuff like that. And again, be very try practicing problems on memory, like the memory virtualization and stuff. You already saw. And,
Can we bring a calculator?
So usually we don't allow calculators for the exams, but I think when I was like having connecting office hours, I saw like most of you using calculators for conversions. So I think it's okay to bring a calculator. Okay, you can bring a calculator for the exam, like a scientific calculator is fine. But just remember that if you are using the calculator on the exam, then maybe you are like for most of the questions, if you're using it like extensively, then maybe you're doing something wrong. So I mean like the questions we have formed, most of the things, maybe you would need the hex conversions sometimes, but the questions would be mostly like trying to understand if you really understand the idea more than if you are able to do the mathematics. Okay? So for example, if you're asking something like, let's say, given this physical address, given this virtual address 200, in this particular scheme, okay, in this particular scheme, can you, like, let's assume it's base and bounds or something like that, okay? In this particular scheme, can you figure out the actual physical address? And if you found that in the physical memory, if you found that the process was loaded here, like, let's say, from 2 KB till like 3 KB or something like this, then this address is just going to be at 200 plus 2 KB plus 200, right? Even answers of this form is fine. You need not even convert the 2 kV to 2024 and then add the 200, we don't even expect those things, okay? So that was the reason. So you can bring calculators, but just make sure that, try not to use them. If you're using them, you may be wasting some time on some unnecessary details that you're not very comfortable. But it may be helpful, yeah. Use it. Any other questions about the exam?
Will there be questions like, this paragraph has something wrong with it, please underline what's wrong and tell us why it's wrong?
Yeah, there can be questions like that as we had on the worksheet. Yeah, it's like possible, but I'm not saying like it will be there. Yeah. Out of the three main themes for this class, or like let's assume it's four, we have the virtualization. And we have two parts in it. We started with CPU virtualization, and then we moved on to memory virtualization. And these are the, this is the whole topic for the exam that you have day after tomorrow. And the second topic for this in this course is like concurrency. The third one is about persistence. We have already completed this and completed this. Now we are right here, okay? Now we are here. And I would suggest like, so based on the feedback from previous students, I feel like this is one of the most interesting parts of the course. Along with the previous things also, but this is like very interesting and it will be really useful in like real world programming. Whatever we are learning here is going to be useful in real world programming. And it is also like really difficult in a way, like if we really want to become a good, if you really want to become a good programmer who can write concurrent programs, then we need to like think a lot about concurrency in a way like, we'll see in today's class, like what is the mindset that we need to have if we are like working with concurrent programs. And definitely at some point in time, if while we are learning like concurrency, at some point in time, if your head like really hurts, then I think you're doing something like right, okay? You're really trying to understand concurrency. And okay, so let's just start with like a high level introduction of like what do we mean by concurrency here. I think we already spoke a little bit about concurrency on the first day of the lecture. So it's more like till now we were only considering the abstraction of a process. We are saying like there is like whenever we want to like schedule something or run something on a particular machine, we create a process. Let's assume if this is the process, okay? We create this particular process. Let's say it's process P. And then we just, once it is created, the scheduler just takes this particular process and schedules it on the CPU. This is the CPU, the scheduler just takes this particular process and schedules it on the CPU and this process starts running. And if you want to do some other task, then you create like a different process. Let's say this is like P, then this may be P2, and then this process may do something altogether, okay? Something different, okay? and then, now, first, before moving to concurrency, between these two processes, okay, what are the things that are shared? So you may think about the address space of each processes, okay? Of each, is there anything that is shared between process P and P2? So with respect to the address spaces, there is nothing shared, okay? So P has its own code, own data, own stack, and own heap. In the same way, P2 has its own code, data, stack, and heap. But at least a few things that are shared here at this level, at the process level, is something like the in the kernel part of the address space, we have the kernel code, right? We have the kernel static data. Those things would actually be shared in the sense like In the physical memory, those things are going to be the same. Okay? So, but don't worry about this. But here, basic idea is at the user part of the address space, at the use, in the user level of the address space, these processes, P1 and P2, have nothing that is shared, okay? And then, but now if you want to like build, let's say a web server, assuming this is a web server, and all this wants to do is, there are like we, like multiple people are trying to connect to this particular web server, and we have a queue of, let's say we have a queue inside. Whenever a person is trying to connect to this particular web server, we just take that particular connection, let's say this is connection one, okay, and place that particular person's request on this queue, and then process, there is some processing that is done. So at a very high level, whenever multiple connections are coming, there may be, if this, let's assume this web server is like a single program, okay, or a single process. Within the single process, there will be like a thread of execution here, okay, or multiple threads of execution here, which whose purpose or whose task will just be to accept some connections, accept incoming connections. Okay, they accept some incoming connections and they just place those, some details about those connections here on this particular queue or something like this, okay? And then there will be another set of threads, okay? Let's assume there is another set of threads here whose job will just be to process or processing. They will be just processing these connections, doing some work that the particular client requires. And there may be like totally more threads here on the other side, which may be just like dealing with sending some like output. After this processing, the task of like replying to those clients can be handled by another threads of execution. So in this simple example, here we are just saying like a single program can have more than like one thread of execution, and all those threads together are trying to achieve like a same task, okay? Here, these could have been like different processes also, but we will just see like why it may be better to use threads in this particular case, okay? So this is like these threads, there can be multiple threads here that accepts like the incoming connections from the client, and then the other set of threads just process those connections, do some work for those clients, and the last set of threads just like send some output to the clients, okay? Very high level, this may happen. So now when we're just talking about thread, let's see like what do we mean by a thread. So when we start a particular process, okay, when we start a particular process, by default, we have something called the main thread of execution. So even though we weren't using threads till now, whenever we just wrote a C program and when we started a particular process, the process when it starts running at main, that particular main, when we are running in main, even though we didn't explicitly create any threads, there was a main thread of execution that was running there, okay? And now, after, when the main starts, now we can, let's assume we create two threads. If we create two threads, T1 and T2, in this case, there are like, at this particular, after these two threads are created, there are currently three threads of execution, okay? What does it mean? Let's just look at this. And usually, in diagrammatic ways, like threads are just like expressed like this, okay? If something is drawn like this, it's just like a thread of execution, okay? Let's see like what it means. So as of now, let's just define a thread as just a component of a process. By that here, we mean like a single process can contain one or more threads, okay? Now, to understand threads in more detail, let's assume what are the things, let's just talk about like what are the things that like the threads can share. Let's just take these two threads as of now, threads T1 and T2. Let's just see like what are the things that a thread usually shares, okay, thread of threads. Yeah. So the things that But even before sharing, okay, Stack is sharing, it's fine. So let's see what are the things that threads will share. So any like ideas from whatever we saw before, just like simple example that we saw before. Exactly. So one of the answers was the threads may share, the threads will share a key, okay? Have it here. The threads are going to share the heap that the process contains. Okay, any other things that you think the thread is going to share? So the thing was like, are they all under the same process ID? Yeah, so they belong to the same process, okay? But internally, each thread is going to have a thread ID. So you may consider this to be like the thread ID of the main thread can be 0, thread ID for T1 can be 1 and 2 and stuff like that, okay? So they really don't share that particular thread ID information, but they are part of the same process. Any other things the threads may share? So, yeah.
Static data?
Exactly, so threads are going to share static data. So here we mean like the global variables or the static variables that we have in, even before the main program, that particular region or the static data region is going to be shared by the two threads here. Any other thing? The stack, okay. Let's just like think about this. So the answer was the stack. Can someone like, does someone have like a counter argument to this? Can the threads?
Don't they have different like registers, like the pointer and stuff? So maybe it can't share this.
Yeah, so other, this is like a different thing. So they have like, let's say different registers, okay? So they are not going to share the registers, the set of registers.
But that means they can't share the stack because we use the stack to store registers, so it would get mixed up, right? Never mind.
Exactly. Yeah, so these are like very good things. I'll just try to like, so the stack, okay, the stack is not going to be shared by the threads.
Not always, because
okay, the stack is not going to be shared by the threads. Let's see why. So here we'll start writing something like not shared.
Pretty sure.
First thing is definitely the stack. Yeah, that's a very good question again. And then how does this work? They're sharing like part of the things, like part of the address space, like the static data, the heap, and they also share the code, okay? The code segment, both the threads are going to share the code segment. And a good name for all these things together is just like the address space of the particular process. If the threads share the address space of a particular process, then how can they have their own stack, okay? So let's go to that like in a few minutes, but as of now, just believe me, the threads are not going to share the same stack. And other things that the threads are not going to share are, let's think about the two threads, okay? So let's think about the example that we saw on the first day of class, where two threads were trying to just increment a shared counter, okay? So the example is again, there is this thread 1 and thread 2, both are trying to just implement a shared counter. By shared here we mean this counter is in the data segment or it's a static or a global variable, okay? So this counter is being, two threads are trying to increase them. Let's say this is trying to increase it by 100 times and this is trying to increase it by one more 100 times. So the final value we are expecting it to be 200. Okay, when in this particular example, let's just think about thread 1 can be counting at let's say 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 till 10. At that time, thread 2 can be counting like somewhere else. In the sense they need not be synchronized or anything. So thread 1 can run its own code and thread 2 can run its own code. So even though they are sharing the same code segment, thread 1 can be executing, let's say function A, and thread 2 can be executing function B. Does it make sense? Yeah, exactly. So when two threads can execute different parts of the same program, okay, When two threads, if they can be executing different parts of the same program at the same time, then it means that they are not going to share the program counter or the instruction pointer, because they are going to have like different values of the program counter or the instruction pointer. In a similar way, threads are not going to share the general purpose registers like the EAX, EBX, ECX, and stuff like that. By that mean, when we are going and executing some code in thread 1, that would have modified all these registers in a certain way, and thread 2 would have modified all these registers in a completely different way. Does it make sense? Because it is doing its own stuff there. And so, like the general purpose registers like EAX, okay, whatever general purpose registers are there, all these are not going to be shared. And if you think about it, the stack pointer and the base pointers registers are not going to be shared, because they are executing something totally different, and so they are having something totally different on their stacks. Thread 1 may be executing a function to sum two numbers. At the same time, thread 2 may be executing a function to multiply two numbers. So they may have like totally different stack pointers and base pointers. Okay? So all these things, you can just combine them to be, they don't share the registers. Basically, okay? They don't share any registers. And so if they don't share any of these registers, okay, and if we also say like they have a different stack, okay, now is it like clear why do they have different stacks? Because they are executing their own code like concurrently or like at the same time. Thread 1 is doing something different, and whenever, let's say, thread 1 is calling functions A, B, and C, while thread 2 is calling functions X, Y, and Z, and both these things should happen at the same time. But stack can only like grow in one direction. So you can't use the same stack to handle both these threads. Okay? And so what internally will happen is the address space, okay? Till now we had a very simple view of the address space. I'm just talking about the user part of the address space, okay? Till now, the user part of the address space, you just have something like the code. We have the static data, then we have the heap, and then we have the stack here, right? Now, how it's going to get modified is, again, threads share the same address space, and so you still have the code here for both the threads. The data is again shared by both the threads. The heap is also shared by both the threads, okay? But the stack, let's assume there was a stack here. This may be the stack of the main thread, okay? The main thread that just starts running initially, it has its own stack. Let's assume this is the stack of the main thread. And when it created two other threads, T1 and T2, let's assume the stack was trying to like grow some thread here, okay? Then when the first thread was created, then within this part of unallocated memory, okay, this first thread would have its own stack in the sense. The stack for the first thread would come somewhere here. It becomes like really more ugly, the address space, but it just happens like this is the stack of the thread T1. And there can be another place where this is the stack of the thread T2, and both are growing downwards, okay? Something like this. So, yeah.
Does each thread get only a part of the whole processing stack, or does each thread get its own like whole stack piece?
So here, like what, there is like no fixed portion of the processor stack. The processor stack just starts somewhere there. So we are not going to allocate these two things within the main thread stack.
Okay.
These are going to be outside because they are separate threads of execution. Okay?
XV6
use threads?
No,
6v6 doesn't use threads. And so,
sure,
yeah, the interesting thing is like project 4, we'll be like implementing kernel threads in XV6. we'll be making like XV6 like a threaded operating system. Okay? Not like exactly, it'll be a very simplified version of it, okay? Don't worry about it. And so here, it's like we have the main thread, and then we have the thread T1, and then we have the thread T2, all have different stacks, but the entire address space that this all these threads are using are the address space of the same process P. Okay, does it make sense? So at some point, stack of the thread one can be like so long because it is like it may have called like a lot of functions, like nested functions, and it may be like so big. But at the same time, the stack of thread two may be like really small because it is just one function deep or something like that. So it really depends on what that particular thread is doing, how big these stacks are. Yeah, that's a very good question again. So till now, we were thinking like the scheduler, when it wants to schedule something, it just picks something at the process level, right? And so now what really happens? How can the scheduler decide which thread to run? It can just pick a process, a scheduler process, but within a process, currently we have like three threads of execution, main, thread one, and thread two. How does this work? It's a great question. And so for all these three threads, very similar to a process control block that we have for a single process, okay? Now the threads are going to have something called a thread control block. Okay? So now this is the abstraction that the operating system creates for handling threads. So this is like very similar to a process control block. But the only things are the set of registers that it is going to have in the thread control block for its context is going to just belong to this particular thread. So in this case, in our simple example, we may be having like three thread control blocks. There is like a thread control block for main thread. There will be a thread control block for thread T1 and another thread control block for thread T2. And so, because we have thread control blocks, the actual thing that a scheduler chooses, okay, the actual thing that the scheduler picks to schedule is going to be a thread. Okay? It's not going to just choose a process. I'm going to run this process P. It's not going to do that. It's just going to choose, okay, there are these many threads currently. I don't care about like which process it belongs to. It may care based on the scheduling like policy, but I'm just saying like if there is just one process running, let's assume if this is a only process that is running, it has three threads of execution. The scheduler just schedules, let's say, it is going to definitely start with the main thread because main thread is the first thread that will run, and it creates threads T1 and T2. And then when these two threads are created, the choice is completely with the scheduler. Okay, and so throughout the part where we are going to learn about concurrency, all the problems that we are going to solve are mainly because scheduler just schedules something at the wrong time. If you remember the counter example, right? There were like the single statement like the counter equals counter plus one, if you remember, the single statement in assembly, it was like split up into three separate statements, and the whole problem just happened that we are seeing. We are going to look at that problem again, don't worry. But the whole problem that happened was just because scheduler chose to switch between, context switch between the two threads at the wrong time. Okay? What is the wrong time? We'll just look at it sometime. But the mindset that we should have whenever we are like learning concurrency is always okay, just have this. just always think that you are the evil scheduler, because scheduler, if scheduler, and if scheduler can really understand how the threads work, and if it can schedule them accordingly, then there is going to be no problems. But since the scheduler just scheduled something at the wrong time, you'll be facing a lot of problems. Let's see some of the problems in today's class. So any questions till now? So the thread control block is very similar to a process control block. It has a set of registers, the context of that particular thread. Then it has the address space. It has a pointer to the address space, basically. Address space in the sense the page directory. And it has like the list of open files that this thread has opened. Whatever, so this is like, this is just a different name. You can just think that this is just a different name. Till now, we are considering only at the process level, and so we are considering it as process control blocks. The one main difference is, okay, let's assume if there are like two processes, P1 and P2, and if these are the PCBs for those particular processes, okay, these are the two PCBs for those particular processes. This is going to have something, a field called page directory, like in a two-level page table. The PCB of, this is the PCB, okay, of P1, this is the PCB of P2. There is going to be a field called page directory. And usually, if these are two separate processes, then this is going to point to a different, like let's say page directory 1, which is specific to this particular process, which has all the information about the virtual memory virtualization, where this virtual page is placed in the physical memory, okay? And this is going to point to a totally different page directory, okay? So since we have a two-level page table, we are talking in terms of page directories, okay? If it was just a simple linear page table, this is going to be just like a page table, a pointer to a page table, okay? So you may also look at see this particular field like PGDIR in XV6's process control block or the proc structure, okay? And these are like two different page directories. But with, let's assume these three PCBs again are going to contain a field called page directory, because they also need this page directory for trying to figure out where the actual virtual pages are placed in the physical memory. But here, the only difference is all the three threads are going to point to the exactly the same page directory. So there is just going to be like one page directory for this whole process. All the threads are just going to point to the same page directory, which means this address space is shared between all these three threads. Does it make sense?
So is there a process control block even exist anymore at this point, or is it?
Yeah, so whenever we move to threads, okay, we really don't even have a separate process control block. Okay, it's just the thread control blocks after that. But they will have something like a common field called, let's say, PID, which will be common across all these threads. They will have like a specific field called TID, called a thread ID, which will be unique for that particular thread. So, and after that, only a combination of the PID and the TID will be unique across the whole system. Does it make sense?
Yeah. Sorry, I don't know. Did you say that like in reality there aren't actually process control blocks? It's all just thread blocks? Okay.
Exactly. So in reality, let's assume if you go and take a look at the code for Linux, Linux has something called a task struct, very similar to the proc struct that we have in XV6. Linux has something called a task struct, which is nothing but a TCB or a thread control block. And so the basic unit of scheduling will be threads in real world operating systems. So let's assume if it only has thread control blocks, the structure may look something like this, okay? Let's assume Think of something like a P table, okay?
Not really.
This is like PID 1, process 1, and TID 1. PID 1, TID 2, PID 1, TID 3. And then there may be another things, another two things with PIDs to be 2 and TIDs to be 1. This is what it's trying to say. So it's going to be just like only with that PID, you can find out if all these things belong to the same process. And in Linux, I think they just call it as the process group. There's something called a process group, and inside that you have all the threads for that particular process.
Yeah. Isn't it a waste of space to have the duplicative information across threads in the same process? And the only duplicative information, it sounds like, is the pointer to the address space, but would you maintain a separate table or something to figure out the address space for each process?
No.
So that you didn't have to repeat it?
No. Yeah. So they don't do that. So we don't like separate information that is like a common, because if we are not storing the entire process table. So the question was, do we have a separate data structure where we can just separate out the fields that are common for all the threads? We don't have something like that because the space for process control block is really not so big because usually they are just pointers. Is pointers to larger structures. Okay, so each of these TCBs, all these are TCBs, each will have its own pointer to the page directory, its own pointer to a context structure where it stores the value of the registers, stuff like that. And so I was just saying, so after this, it's going to be just like, if you take like process one, thread one, you can't find any other TCB which has both these things to be the same. Process 1 and thread 1 cannot be found anywhere else. This is unique across this mission. Okay. Good questions. Any other question about threads? If there are like no more questions, let's just like look at a simple example. So here, so here, now we are like going into the like details of like how do we create threads. So let's start from the main, okay? So this may be like very similar, or like you may be familiar with this code because you saw a similar code in the first lecture, but we may go into some more details now, okay? So now in main, you first just come and check the number of arguments and you just see like it should be exactly one. If it is not exactly one, then just like exit. And then line 18, okay, at line 18, we are creating two threads with the name P1 and P2. You may just name it T1 and T2, it should be fine. So here in pthread underscore T is the type of a particular thread. So pthread just stands for POSIX threads, okay? It's a type of threads that we use in C, C++. And for this to work, you should have this include file pthread.h, okay? That is the library for this. And then here you are just like declaring two threads. You're just saying like, I want to like declare two threads with the names P1 and P2. And then we print something here. And then, okay, this line is the most interesting as of now. So line 20, we create a particular thread. What do we mean by creating a particular thread in this context is This line just says, okay, we are calling a function called pthread_create, and we are passing in the address of the first thread that we just declared, okay? We are passing in the address of the first thread, and the second argument is some attributes about the thread. If you want to do some fancy stuff, but don't worry about it, we will not be doing anything fancy. You want to like know what these attributes mean, you may like look at the man pages, we will take a look at it right now. And the third thing is just a name of a function that this thread should execute, okay? When this thread gets created, which function should this thread start executing? And the last argument here is just like a particular argument that you are passing to that particular function. Okay, the thread is going to execute a function called myThread, and the last thing is just like a particular argument that you are passing into that particular function. In this case, we are assuming like P1 is passing A, okay, which we assume that P1 is just thread A and P2 is just thread B. We're just passing in the name of those threads. That's all we are doing here. Now let's go and take a look. Before we proceed, let's take a look at the pthread create. Okay, so here in pthread create, so the first thing is just a pointer to a pthread, which we just gave as ampersand P1. And the second argument is some attributes. You may take a look at it later if you're interested, but it's not needed for the purposes of this class, okay? And then this is the most interesting thing here. This is just like a C, some feature in C. Can someone like figure out like what this means? The whole thing is just the third argument, type of the third argument. What is this type? Exactly. So this is just a function pointer. What do we mean is this third argument that we're expecting here is going to be some address of a function or a pointer to some particular function. And this syntax just means, okay, then let's assume this is the name of this function, like start routine, okay? And this function is going to take in an argument of type void star. Okay, it's just going to take in an argument of type void star, and this function should return an argument of type void star. And the other star here, the asterisk here that we have, is just the syntax to tell the compiler that this is nothing but the start routine is nothing but a pointer to a function. Okay, it's a pointer to a function. That's all this is saying. So start routine, the third argument that you're passing in here should be a pointer to a function that takes as input void star, and it returns a pointer to void. Void star is nothing but a pointer to void. And can you think of like why, okay, maybe let's think of that later. The question was why do they have like void star as the argument type and void star as the return type? It may be clear when we look at the code here. Let's just take a look. And the last thing, okay, the last thing that we are pointing, the fourth thing that we are passing is just like the argument to that particular function. So you call a function called startRoutine for this particular thread, and you pass in a set of arguments. Okay, let's assume you pass in a set of arguments, and the arguments should be of type void star, because the function that you are passing them in takes in a type void star, a pointer to void. Okay, the reason, let's just check this here. Okay, can you think of the reason why it's important to have it as void star as the argument type and void star as the return type? Exactly. So the reason is, okay, the reason is when we are creating this thread, we may pass in an integer, or we may pass in like a string, or we may pass in a structure. It can be like any data type basically. Okay, so this thread should be able to accept any type of data as its input argument. And the only way to do that is saying like this is a pointer to void, which actually doesn't mean anything, but it just means the reason that we are using this here is, in C, we can typecast any pointer, any type of pointer to a void star pointer. Okay, so if we are passing in a structure, let's say struct S, which has like 10 arguments, sorry, 10 fields within it, you can just easily typecast that particular structure, struct S, to a void star. So in this particular example, we are passing in a char star, basically, right? It's a char star pointer. The A in double quotes is just a string in C, which is a pointer to a character. And here, automatically, it is being, not automatically, if you see here, it takes in, we pass it in as a char star, but when this thread function reads it, okay, it just reads it as a void star, that is fine, but internally, when you want to use that particular structure or like that particular pointer, again, you have to typecast it back to the original type that you knew that you passed it in. Does it make sense? So you can actually typecast any type, any pointer type to a void star pointer type. That is the reason we have both the input arguments and the output of this particular function to be void star. And here, this does not, this star actually belongs to the void, okay? It is, this whole thing is the return type, and this is just the name of the function here, myThread, and then we just say we are passing an argument of type void star, okay? Because usually people can easily get confused with what is happening here with all those stars here. And here, even though we are saying like we should pass in the pointer to that particular method, in C, doing something like ampersand myThread, having ampersand before the function name, or just writing the function name just means the same thing. Okay? Both, just if you just write a function name, it just returns the address of that particular function. So when you try to print, you can print percentage %p, comma, main. It just prints the address of main. Okay, in a similar way here, passing in something like this or just the name just means we are passing in the address of that particular function. That particular function will have some address in the code segment and we are passing in that particular address. And this is the argument to that particular thing. Okay, so many details here. Now, after this line 20 is executed, okay, there are going to be two threads of execution in this particular process. What are the two threads?
Main and P1.
Exactly. One is main, which is the default thread. We really don't create a main thread. Whenever the main program starts executing, it has started the main thread of execution, okay? And then after this line 20 is executed, now there is another thread called P1. Okay, now there are two threads. But as programmers, we really don't have any control after this particular point about like what is going to run. Either the main, if there is only one CPU, okay, either the main thread can run or the thread T1 can run. Okay, let's assume now. Let's assume the main thread runs. If it runs, okay, we are going to execute line 21 immediately. Okay, but at that time, thread T1 is going to be within this function called myThread. So this is the most important thing here, okay? So here at line 20, after line 20 is executed, now we have two threads of execution. One threads, the main thread's instruction pointer or the program counter is going to be pointing at line 21. Okay, let's assume this 21 is the address, okay? It's going to be pointing at 21. And the thread T1 or P1, thread P1's instruction pointer is going to be pointing at line 8. Because that's what's going to run next. But we really don't have any control over which is going to run. We can't say after line 20, we really can't say if the next line that is going to run is line 21 or line 8. Either can happen. Because it just depends on the scheduler, which thread that it just picks, okay? So now let's assume the scheduler picks the main thread to run. So we will run 21 and we are creating the second thread P2 here. So after the second thread is created, now there are three threads of execution, main, P1 and P2. Again, we don't have any control over which is going to run. Okay, the scheduler just chooses whichever it likes. And then, I mean, based on the scheduling policy and stuff, and we just like, run that particular thing. Let's assume at this time still, if still the main thread runs, it is going to come here and we have called something called pthread join. Okay, let's just see what this means. So the pthread join function waits for the thread specified by this thread to terminate. If that thread has already terminated, then pthread join returns immediately. The thread specified by thread must be joinable. But don't worry about the other details, but it's just like here, what we're just doing is, we are just waiting at this line, we are just waiting for the thread P1 to complete its execution. Only if P1 is done, if it has exited, then this particular line will return. Else, the main thread is struck at line 23. Okay? If P1 is still running, main thread is struck at line 23. Let's assume P1 now is scheduled, and if it completes this particular thing, it's just going to print A or B here, okay? It's just going to print A or B, and then, so P1 is going to print A, P2 is going to print B, and then at line 24, we are again waiting for the thread 2 to complete. And then we are going and saying like main end, and then we are exiting the program. Any questions till now? Okay, let's just try running this. So one linker option that we should provide here, whenever we are using threads, is called pthread. Provide this linker option whenever we are compiling some program that has like threads in it. So you see here, okay, the first time that we ran, the output was, the second time we ran, the output was different than the first time that we ran. The first time the main thread began, then even though thread 1 was created before thread 2, for some reason the scheduler just decided to run thread 2 or the thing that prints B. And then it printed A, and then the main end. And again, we have, in the second run, it was just like the main starting, and then, yeah, we have the A, and then B, and then end. You can just see here, it's like indeterminate, basically. You can't like really expect like what is going to happen here. And this is what creates all the problems that you're going to see, okay? That you create threads, you really don't have any control like how they are scheduled. Okay, and we usually threads, usually when we create multiple threads, here, okay, in this example, both the threads were just trying to go and run the same function called myThread, okay? In real world, you can assume that that's not going to be the case, in the sense, it's not going to be as simple as this. It's going to be like thread 1 may be performing something different. Thread 2 can run, let's say, function 2, which is totally different, okay? It can happen in that way. Or else, both the threads can also do the same function, something like, let's assume there is a linked list, and if there are like 100 threads that are trying to insert into the linked list at the same time, then all the threads at the same time are going to call the function called list insert. Okay? And all are going to try to insert in this linked list at the same time, and just assume what bad things may happen if they are not coordinated. Okay, if the insert is not coordinated, just not even 100, just think about two threads are trying to insert into the same linked list. What are the bad things that happen? We will be looking at that also in a few seconds. So, any questions? No? Okay. So again, here, like we are not going into the details of like everything line by line, but again, at a very high level, we are creating two threads, okay? We are creating two threads, and then we have a variable called balance here, okay? We have a variable called balance, which is in the static section, which is in the the data section. So just think about that. And here, this is again very similar to the piece of code that we saw in the first day of class. We create two threads, and both the threads are just trying to update the same shared variable, okay, the counter variable. But before that, let's see, again, we just create these two threads, we wait for these two threads, and in these threads, we call a function called myThread, which is just here. We can just focus on this function as of now. So in this function, we just get that particular argument, and have it as a local stack variable, and then we have another stack variable called I, okay, and then we print the address of balance and the address of I. So the first question, okay, here is the address of balance. Let's just take the address of the variable called balance. Is it going to be the same when the two threads are printing the address of balance, or is it going to be different?
Same.
How many of you think it's going to be the same? Okay. How many of you think it's going to be different? Okay, so the answer is it's going to be the same, okay, because this, the thing that we have here, the balance, where is it declared? It is declared even before main, which makes it a global variable, and all the global variables reside in a section of the address space called the static data. And the static data is shared by all the threads. If you remember whatever we saw before, static data is shared by all the threads, and so it is there. And but the variable I that we have is on the stack, right? It's a local stack variable, which is inside the function called myThread. And so since threads have like different stacks, their own private stacks, this particular variable I is not going to be shared. It's just going to be different. Two different I's are going to exist, variable I's, but there is just one variable balance which is shared between the two threads. And then, so this makes things complicated here, because if you see here, you have the, you just go and this max is just like got as an argument from the program, what is the maximum value that you want to add this counter, and you just go and do this for loop those many times to increase the balance. Let's say if you give the input as 100, first thread is trying to calculate, increase it 100 times, and the second thread is also trying to increase it 100 times, but all the problems are going to happen because this balance is a shared variable. What happens, what may happen, or what will be the output if we just replace this balance with the variable, let's say, I, or if we just move this balance within the function myThread, what do you think will happen? What will be the output of this balance? Pardon? Exactly. So if the variable balance, that balance, if it is inside the function myThread, then it becomes a local stack variable, which is local for each thread, and thread 1 just updates its own balance from 0 to 100, and thread 2 just updates its own balance from 0 to 100. Okay, they just don't share that particular thing. But in this case, both are going to share this particular thing, and as we already saw, it needs this loop count to run. So it just like it was fine adding till 200, and so the balance should be 200, and the balance is currently 200. So both the threads just added like 100 times, and similarly here 1000, there is no problem, and with 10,000 the problem starts. See here, the important thing here is like here the result was correct, okay? So with concurrent programs, if you just like execute it once or even multiple times, and if you see like correct results, it doesn't mean that your program is correct. Okay? That's going to be the hard thing again. So here you may see the correct value multiple times, but still that just doesn't mean that your program is written in a correct way. And here in this case, you can see that the result is indeterministic. Okay? And so this type of, these types of programs, so what is happening here is, again, two threads are trying to update the counter at the same time. They are racing to update that particular counter. And so this particular condition that this program exhibits is called a race condition. These are the terms that is frequently used in concurrent programming. Two threads are racing to update the same shared variable. And so there is a race condition in this particular program. And the region of code where this race condition happens is called the critical section. So this line of code, line number 18, is called the critical section, because that is the section that is critical within these two threads, and so it should be protected in some way. Okay? So it's a critical section, and the results are not deterministic, and so these are like indeterminate programs. Okay, and there's one more key word that they use frequently in concurrent programming. I don't remember it right now. Maybe we'll come to that sometime later. So any questions? Okay, I think it's a good time to take a break now. We'll take a 10 minutes break, and we'll be, time is like 6:30. I think these are the three lines. You just see these three lines, okay? It's moving some contents from a memory location. Okay, the first line just says like we are moving some contents from the memory location. Maybe I'll try compiling this with the 32-bit machine. It's maybe slightly simpler. So here in my thread, now if you see, okay. Little easy to understand, okay? So here I just compiled the same program for a 32-bit machine, and so the registers and everything would be different, okay? And so in this case, now we are moving some contents from some memory location, which is the memory location associated with the variable called balance that we had in the program, and we just load that particular value to the register called EAX, and then in the next line, we just add one to the register's value. And in the third line, we just store the register's value to the memory location wherever balance was. So you can see like the two memory locations that are used in these programs are exactly the same. So we are just loading some value from memory location, adding one to it, and storing it in the same memory location. But the problem occurs when some event like this happens. So the same thing, okay, the problems occur when, so first thing, okay, the first case that we have here is like thread 1 runs the three instructions, and after thread 1 runs three instructions, we have a context switch to thread 2, and then thread 2 runs these three instructions. So you can see here, initially the value of EAX is 0, and then the balance is like, if it is 100, then thread 1 loads this value to EAX, and in the next line, value is added by 1, and in the third line, this value is moved to the variable called balance. And then in the second, and then a context switch happens. So in the second thread, now we can clearly observe that the new value of the balance 101 is like loaded to EAX to the register. 1 is added, and then it is stored back in the same position. If the scheduler just made the switch in a similar way after these three instructions, then there is nothing that is problematic. But it can easily happen like this. Thread 1 loads value of 100 to the EAX register, adds 1. Before thread 1 stores this value back into the memory location, a context switch happens. This is the problem, okay? So when this happens, in this line, we are loading the old value of EAX, because we haven't updated, the thread 1 hasn't updated the new value yet. And so we are loading the old value, adding 1 to it, and then storing it back. Now thread 2 has already executed all three instructions, and now another context switch happens back to thread 1. Now thread 1 just tries to continue from wherever it left off. Where it left off was right in the middle of the critical section, right? And so here, we are just like moving the value 101 back here. So even though we are expecting the value to be 102 because two threads have added once, the final value is 101. Okay, so this is the problem. Scheduler just scheduled something at the wrong time, and then this problem was created. We already saw how do we fix this. Using something called locks, okay? And locks are going to be like one of the major topics that we are going to discuss throughout concurrency, okay? So let's just start seeing like what it means. So here, very similar to a peak thread underscore T. The underscore T just stands for type. Okay, here we are creating something of type pthread mutex, okay? And the mutex here just stands for mutual exclusion, okay? We are creating a lock, and we have just named the lock as lock, okay? This is just name of a variable of type pthread mutex. And we are initializing it to something. So before we actually use the lock, we should initialize the lock with this particular initializer, or there is another method called pthread mutex init. Okay, there is a method called pthread mutex init. You can also call the particular method to initialize locks, and we will be using these two things interchangeably. Okay, and then once you have this initialized this lock, you just come and you can just add this lock like around the critical section. Okay, so since this balance thing was the critical section, but first I think here slightly. It should be, since we just told like the line 18, this was the critical section, you can just add this particular thing like right here, okay? Just before and after the critical section. Okay, so we just like have it here. So what this is saying is, before you access this line balance equals balance plus 1, which is a critical section, you have to acquire this particular lock. And once you acquire this lock, you can enter the particular thread, can enter the critical section, and before it exits the critical section, or after it exits the critical section, it can just do an unlock with that, of that particular mutex. So you're just locking something, and then you're unlocking at the end, okay? You're acquiring a lock, and then you're just releasing the lock. That's all this is happening here. So now with this, let's just try running this. Now we can see like multiple runs of 10,000, we get the same value, okay? But let's just see something like, let's just increase this to like 100,000. It still works. Let's say 1 million. Still works, but there is like some delay, if you can see that. We like 10 million. There was like some significant delay, you see that? But let's just try the first program that we ran, like without the logs, okay? If I just run for 1 million or 10 million times without the logs, let's see what's happening. Even though it's computing the wrong result, it's like really fast, do you see that? Really fast, but if we just do it with this thing, there is some significant delay here. I guess why?
You have the locks, or it looked like you had the locks around the entire loop, and so it had to finish all of those before it would let the other process or the other thread touch it. And so if you put the critical section, which is actually the operation of adding one, would that speed it up?
Exactly. So yeah, so the problem was, okay, that would definitely speed it up, yes. But the problem here now, I think, was we have the locks just above the critical, I mean, just above that single line, or surrounding that single line of code, okay? So we have something like main thread 1.c. You see here, we have this lock just surrounding this particular thing. So what does this mean? Exactly, for each and every time, the program is going to increment the counter. It's going to acquire the lock and then increment the counter and then release the lock, okay? And the same thing happens with thread 2. Thread 2 is also going to do the same thing. But, so these types of locks are called like fine-grained locks, okay? The things we have a fine grain thing here where for each and every update, just make sure you acquire the lock, and then once you make that particular update, just release the lock, okay? This fine-graining is very useful for concurrency, but at the same time, as we just saw here, it's going to have some overhead. Okay, because you are doing some extra work of acquiring and releasing a log. So you may think of like when you acquire a log, you are going to call a function for acquiring the log, okay? A pthread mutex log is nothing but a function in the pthread library, okay, which actually has some mechanism for you to make sure that when after you acquire the log, no one else can enter that particular critical section. So now, okay, the high level idea is, okay, when you have logs like this, it has some overhead and it decreases the amount of time or increases the amount of time that we run the same code, okay? So now, just to sure, like we can just try moving this particular thing on top of the for loop. Okay, now I just moved the locking and the unlocking. And now I consider the entire loop or like the entire thing to be a critical section. Does it make sense? So when a program starts, I'm just saying it can just increment it continuously. While it is incrementing it, no one else can enter that particular piece of code. But once it is done completely, the other thread can enter the piece of code, okay? And then it can start doing its work. If this is the case, let's just run the same, just compile this thing, and if you run this now, you see? So just to make sure that it is actually slow or actually fast, there is a Unix command called time. You can just like add time to the beginning of this. You can see it's like some 0.056 seconds. You can just look at this real time. Okay, this is fine for us, for our sake. Just look at this real time. It's like 0.056 or 55, something like this in this range. When we do that lock on the whole for loop, okay? But let's just do it again, like the, we'll just try changing this to as we had previously. Now if we run the same time command, now we can see like it's definitely significantly higher. Okay, the real time is like some nearly 3 seconds. Okay, and run multiple times and see. This is actually a very good tool, okay? And the real just means like what is the total time that it has taken from the start till the end for this particular program. User means how much time this particular program has spent in the user part of the user code, okay? The user code section, and how much time it has spent in the kernel code. These are the things that gives a split of things, okay? But you can observe that the total time, okay, can be less than the addition of user and the system time or the kernel time together. Can you think of the reason why it can be so? The reason is, okay, I will just say.
Is that the total for each thread?
Pardon?
Is that the total for each thread? Like that total, like each thread actually spent that, so it's like doubling it?
Exactly, so it's more like the real time is just like some time that we are observing from the user's perspective. It started at this time and ended at this time. But the addition of the user and the system is just like the same, that there are multiple threads, okay? So multiple CPUs are being used. So it's the time that is used across the CPUs or across the cores, okay? So multiple, so the same, if there are two threads and if they are running for like, let's say, like 1 second each on two CPUs, okay? If they are running for one, this is not like very important, but I'm just trying to say this is like really interesting. So this your program, if there are two threads and if they are running on two cores or two CPUs at the same time for let's say 1 second each, then the total time of user presses will be 2 in that case, because in total 2 cycles of the CPU or 2 seconds of the CPU are used, but from the user's perspective it was just like 1 second because both happened in parallel, something like that. Okay, you can just go and read the man pages for time for like more details, okay? So our important thing here is like this is taking a lot more time. But now, what was the problem with having it here? What was the problem with having the lock here? Exactly, it locks out the other threads from executing. Any other problems? So since it locks out the other thread, okay, what is basically happening? So it is just like, yeah?
They're not really running concurrent.
Exactly. So since it just locks the entire thing, the two threads are really not running concurrently. Does it make sense? It's just like we are saying, thread one, just run. Complete your entire critical section. Then thread two, you start executing. We are decreasing the concurrency by having a lock like this, okay? So coarse-grained locks like this decreases concurrency, okay? And fine-grained locks increases concurrency, but with the additional overhead of like taking more time, basically. Does it make sense? Yeah, so yeah, this like really, this is like a very simple example here, but you can think of examples like a hash table, okay? If there's a hash table and if there are like multiple buckets in the hash table, when multiple threads are trying to insert into the hash table, a coarse grained lock will just like lock the entire hash table. Whenever any thread is inserting in any bucket, it's going to like just lock the entire hash table. But a fine grained lock, on the other hand, is going to just lock the particular nodes in that particular bucket which the thread is trying to insert. Does it make sense? This is like, in real world, this will be the actual difference. We'll also be looking at some code a similar way. So I think I have a like a handout, okay, just for understanding this concurrent. We have concurrent linked lists here. This handout. Any extras, can you just raise your hands? Just one announcement about the worksheet 6, okay? Usually we have like 2 late days for all worksheets, but for this worksheet, worksheet 6, just make sure that if you haven't submitted it today, just make sure you submit it at least by tomorrow evening, because we are planning to release the solutions. Some students are requesting solutions for worksheet 6, may help them for preparing for the exams. And so we have just make sure that you submit it before tomorrow, okay? So for worksheet 6, there's only 1 late day maximum. And maybe I think let's have it like by 6 p.m. Just have the time to be 6. So how many of you haven't submitted worksheet 6 over here? Okay. I think, yeah, then we can just have it like tomorrow 6 p.m. as the cutoff. Then we'll release the solutions for that particular worksheet, okay? So in this piece of code that I have shared with you, this handout, take a look at the slide that says make this linked list implementation to be thread safe. There are two things here. One is about the linked list, and other thing is about the hash table. Let's start with the linked list, okay? Please take the next like 2 to 3 minutes just to like go through that code. And if you have a code like this, the task here is, and if you are asked to make this code thread safe, okay? So you should assume that there are multiple threads that are trying to run any of these functions that you have here. Okay, how can you make this particular piece of code thread safe? Okay, that is the task here. And don't worry about the details about how do you create a lock and how do you initialize a lock. Just think about what are the regions of code that needs to be locked. Okay, or just try to identify the critical sections in this piece of code. That's the task here. Take like 1 more minute and then we'll discuss. And the task is just mark or circle or put a box around the regions of code that you think is critical section. And two threads are running the same piece of code, what are the lines of code that needs to be locked? I think we've discussed. So first, what are the functions that needs to be protected? There are like, we can see insert, lookup, and print. How many of you think print should be protected? Okay, many of you think lookup should be protected? Okay, the insert. Okay, great. So as you just saw, like a print and lookup are actually, what are they doing? They are just like trying to, so print is just trying to print the linked list, okay? So while we are printing the linked list, there may be multiple threads that may be doing some insertions to the linked list. So when you are printing the linked list, you may be looking at a version, okay, that is stale, or like that is the previous version of the linked list. So here it actually depends on the application. Like if the output, if it doesn't need to be like so up to date of exactly how the list is currently, then you may or may not like protect the print. Okay, in a similar way, the lookup. When you're looking up for some element, okay, there may be some element being added to the linked list. Okay, and at that time, you really it depends on like what you want to do, in the sense. If you're not worrying about, okay, if I search for something and if it is like currently being inserted at the same time, and if I don't worry about if I want to like report it as true or false, then it doesn't matter. But if it is like the application requires that exactly, even while we are looking it up, if some element is added to the end of a linked list or something like that, at that time, if we want that to be updated as, okay, this element is in the linked list, then it depends. So we'll just start with insert. Insert definitely is going to be protected because let's assume a simple linked list, okay, with the head. We have a head, and this linked list just has like currently it just has, let's say, three elements, okay? 1, 2, and 3. Okay, and let's assume thread 1 is trying to execute this particular function. We are writing the details of thread 1 here, and we are going to write the details of thread 2 here. Okay, so thread 1 and thread 2 are currently executing this particular function. Both, is executing concurrently on both the threads, both have its own stack, right? So the variables that we are creating inside this function, the new, let's assume the new, okay? New is going to be, there is going to be one new for thread 1, okay? Which is here, the pointer new is here. And there is going to be another new for thread 2, which is here. And when we create some thing on the stack, okay, and you allocate some memory on the heap, now both the threads are sharing the same heap, okay? So, okay, now this is a very good question, actually questions like this can easily come on the exam, not the exam that's day after tomorrow, but maybe for the final exam, okay? So, now both the threads are sharing the heap. Now, when they execute this particular function, the node that we are going to get for both these threads, is it going to be the same node or a private copy of for each thread? Think about this.
Copy.
So if I print the nodes, the news value after this line, is it going to be the same or different for both the threads?
Different.
It's going to be different, exactly. It's just using the same region of heap, okay? But it's going to be like different, what to say? Whichever allocates first gets the first 4 bytes, and whichever allocates next gets the next 4 bytes, kind of. So here, it can be just like this node that we created here. There are two separate nodes, okay? And new is pointing to these nodes, okay? And then we just check if malloc succeeded properly, and then if so, then we go and add the element. Let's assume we're going to add the element 4, okay? Or both the thing, or this is trying to add the element 4, and this thread is trying to add the element 5. So this inserts 4 in the data part, and this inserts 5 in the data part. Okay, this is the data part, okay? And this is the next pointer, this linked list, okay? And then, till now it's okay. And then now when both, I'm just assuming each line is happening like line 1 in thread 1 and line 1 in thread 2, something like that. Okay, I'm just assuming the order of execution is like line by line in each thread. Okay, we're interleaving in that way. And then after this, now let's assume new.next equals l.head. So it just means new.next is equals list's head is here, okay? So list's head is just pointing here. And so this, we are just in this line, we are just saying, just make this point to the first element in the linked list. So basically, we are doing an insertion at the beginning, okay? We are doing an insertion at the beginning, and if the same line executes here, we are just going to insert here, okay? We are just going to say, now this is going to point to the first element in the linked list. Because at this, we are assuming, now this line, okay, was executed in thread 1 first, and so the first arrow from 4 to 1 was drawn, and the same line is executed in thread 2, and so the arrow from 5 to that particular first element is drawn. And then, now is the most interesting part, this particular line, okay, now we are trying to update the head of the actual linked list, okay? And now when thread 1, let's assume thread 1 runs first, when thread 1 runs first, it just says, now whatever is new, which is this element's address, just make the head point to that. So this reference head now does not point to 1 directly, it points to 4, okay? And thread 1 thinks that I'm done, I just inserted 4 in the linked list, but since another thread, thread 2 was executing concurrently, now thread 2 executes the same line after thread 1 does so. And so now L dot head, thread 2 just says, go and just make this L dot head point to the element that I just inserted. So this is just a pointer, now this value, this reference is gone. This pointer is gone. And so after, if this interleaving happens, after these two threads insert the elements in the linked list, the elements are, the linked list now looks like 5, 1, 2, 3. The insert of thread 1 didn't even happen here, even though it thought that it actually updated the linked list. Pardon?
So
So here, okay, so now these things happen, and now what happened to this element 4? It is just hanging out somewhere on the heap, okay, but it is not referenced by anything. It's basically a memory leak. Okay, that's a memory leak because of this. Okay, this is a memory leak. So now the interesting question comes, okay? We saw all these things. Now, what is the region of code that we should protect? Or what is our critical section, basically? How many of you think it's the last two lines? Just these two lines. Okay? How many of you think it's just the last line? If you think about it, okay, at least, okay, I'm not sure if I'm wrong, but I thought it was just the last line, let's see. So I'm thinking just the last line is the thing that needs to be protected.
But then 5 would skip 4.
Oh, got you, okay. It's going to point it. So if we just like new dot next equals L dot next.
That's the part where we got 4 and 5 both pointing.
Exactly. So I'm wrong, sorry. So it's the last two lines, okay? So now till then, it was not involving anything with the L dot head, okay? It was not having anything with the global list's head. It was just having everything that was local to it. And so now these two lines needs to be protected, okay? But let's assume, this is fine. So here you'll just add a lock here, and then you'll add unlock here. Yeah, that's a very good question. So what happens, okay? What happens if someone, it's not wrong to completely lock the entire insert also, okay? Let's assume if someone locks it here and unlocks it at the last line, okay? Someone locks the entire insert function. Is it fine to do so in this particular case?
It won't make a difference.
If we return without
unlocking, that's the problem.
Exactly. So here, when we do that, if we do a lock here, okay, and then unlock here at this line, okay, then we are just not worrying about the possibility of malloc failing. Okay? If malloc fails, in that case, we locked it here. Yeah, we acquire a lock here. And if malloc fails, we will just return right here. Okay? And so this thread just acquired the lock and it just exited. So no one else can enter the critical section after that. Yeah, exactly. In that case, it's a problem. So the solution is, before returning, just release the lock here. Just unlock it here.
I mean, I guess my question is, would we have to actually lock that call to malloc, or will malloc do that for you so that you don't have two things returning the same memory?
Oh, so yeah, that's a very good question. So is malloc thread safe? Okay, when two threads are trying to call malloc, then should we actually lock the malloc? It actually is dependent on the malloc implementation, but the usual implementation that we have is thread safe. You can assume that it is thread safe. Even if two threads try to call malloc at the same time, that they will be getting two different pointers to two different regions. But you can't assume it like in general. I mean, if you're using a different version of malloc, then you should be very sure that that particular implementation is thread safe.
Is there any way to just indicate that lock and unlock should be called like around the insert function without specifying it right before the return statement, like just indicating that the whole function should be considered lockable section?
Yeah, so the question is, can we have the lock somewhere else, okay, in a way that we can consider the whole function to be locked? So one way to do that is just to have locks in the before even you call that particular function, but I don't think that will work, because if you think about it, the threads call the functions separately, and so this is usually how it works. So yeah, with this here, in the next thing, I don't think we'll be doing it right now, okay? But you can take a look at it later. So here, it is like there is a simple hash table implementation with the linked list, okay? Whatever linked list that we saw before, okay? We are using those linked lists in the buckets of each hash table. And the task here is to make this hash table code thread safe, okay? Just think about it later. Till now, okay. Okay, till now we were like just looking at how do we use locks, okay? How do we use locks? Now the next part of concurrency, we are going to focus more on how are these locks actually implemented? Okay, if given a task to implement a lock like a pthread mutex lock, how can we implement a lock like this? Okay, even before we proceed, okay, we initially saw that we are talking about memory virtualization, because virtualization in general, because the CPU and the memory needs to be virtualized across all running programs. And then the persistence part is about like how do we virtualize the disk, or how do we share the hard disk among all the running programs. Do you have any idea like why are we learning concurrency in an operating systems course? Concurrency doesn't, like, okay, we have threads, we have like thread control blocks, and this is like parallel execution, right? But how does it fit in an operating systems course?
What maintains, like, what process has the lock, or, like, can access it, so, like, is it, what kind of, has, like, a lock table, I guess?
So, definitely it has all those things. Yeah, it has, like, something called a lock table and stuff like that. But still, like, we could have learned it in a, to say, yeah, in a different course, but I'm just trying to understand, like, do you guys have any idea? Yeah, or like, what do you guess?
Well,
Yeah, so when multiple CPUs came into existence, then threads were like born, okay? And when threads were born, the first program that was ever written in a multi-threaded way was the operating system. Okay, so the operating system was the first ever concurrent program. Because just think about it now, if you have like four CPUs, for each of these four CPUs, you need to like run a scheduler. Is that right? And that is why we have in the scheduler, which you would have been very familiar by now, right? In the code, we have like we are locking the P table. Whenever we want to schedule something, because multiple CPUs, each CPU will have its own scheduler, its operating system was the first concurrent program. And so that is the historical reason why we're learning it here in this course. Okay, with this, now we're going to see like how do we actually implement locks. So the first implementation. So the CPU, and I just mean the CPU or the core. Yeah, so I just mean something like, okay, if this is your whole CPU, each CPU can have like multiple cores in it. And if this is like core 0, core 1, core 2, and core 3. Now in this particular CPU, you can actually run four threads at the same time. Four threads of execution can run on this particular CPU. And usually it is like this, even you will have in a single system, you will have like multiple CPUs like this. And they organize it in certain ways. And if you are more interested in these details, like each of these particular, each CPU, then we have something called like NUMA, which is like non-uniform memory access. So these four CPUs has its like own like local memory kind of. The other four CPUs will have its own like local memory. And so NUMA just stands for like non-uniform memory access. It means like if these CPUs are trying to access some memory that is part of the other CPU, then it takes more time than trying to access a memory within here. So, but here in this particular machine, if there are four CPUs with four cores in each CPU, then it just means we can run like 16 concurrent threads at the same time. Okay, 16 threads concurrently because each will have its own core like this. Okay. So now let's just like. Okay, the task here is the same. We are looking at the same program of like incrementing this balance variable. We're looking at the same program of incrementing the balance, which is the critical section here. At this point, we have a lock called a spin lock, okay? But this spin lock is nothing fancy. It is not a pthread mutex lock, okay? It is some function that we just wrote. It is right here. Okay, it is right here. It just says this function takes in a pointer to an integer, unsigned integer, and then it just checks the value within that location. And if it is 1, it is just going to spin, which means like if it is 1, that particular variable has a value of 1. And so it means that the lock is already acquired. Okay, some assumptions here are 0, in this, okay, this is a mutex variable that we have here. Again, this is a very simple unsigned integer variable. Initially, we have it to be 0. 0 means the lock is not held, and 1 means the lock is held. Okay, and in this implementation that we have, in the spin lock implementation that we have, we just have something like, okay, whenever that particular, so here we just pass in the address of mutex, if you can see here, okay, we pass in the address of that particular integer variable. And inside, at line 14, inside that function, we just check the value inside that variable. If that value is 1, it means the lock is already held by someone. So just keep on checking that particular value. And this process of just continuously checking that particular value And just having that semicolon there just means like we are not doing any useful thing, but we're just checking continuously. And this particular thing is called spinning. Okay, by spinning, we are, whenever this particular thread is running on a particular, let's say, core or CPU, then this thread is just spinning, wasting some time there, just checking for that particular value. And if that particular value, that mutex, if it is, let's say, zero, then it means that the lock is not held, so this condition is going to fail, and we will come to line number 16 to directly set that value to 1, which means we have acquired the lock. Okay? So here again, at a high level, we are trying to implement our own lock. Okay? We are trying to implement our own lock. So what this means is, if this function returns, it means that we have acquired the lock. Is that right? So when we are calling this function at line 26, if this function returns, that thread can enter the critical section. Okay, but if this function does not return, and if it is just stuck there, it means that that thread is just waiting because some other thread is in the critical section already, which has already acquired the lock. Okay, that's all we are trying to do here. I'll try to explain some more time. So at line 14, we are just checking what is the value inside that lock. If it is zero, then it is unlocked. And so we can acquire the lock. We acquire the lock at line 16. And when this function returns, we will be at line 27, which is the critical section. Okay? Now let's assume thread 1 just did this, okay, and it is in the critical section already. At the same time, now thread 2 is trying to run, and when it just calls the function spin lock, we will be at line 14 checking for that particular value. Now it is 1 already, because the thread 1 has already acquired the lock, and so we will be just spinning. We'll just keep on checking that value. But after some time, when thread 1 finishes the critical section, it's going to call unlock, spin unlock at line 28. So at that time, here we are going to just say that value, set that value to 0, which just means that thread 1 released the lock. Okay. So at this time, in thread 2, when thread 2 is executed now, when thread 2 checks this particular condition now, it will fail, and so it will acquire the lock. It will set the lock to 1, which is acquiring the lock, and immediately enter the critical section, which is balance. Okay? That is all what is happening here. Now the question for you is, will this work? Will this lock implementation work? Or are there any issues here? And these are the type of questions that we will be you may try thinking about this, okay? I'm just trying to say, questions like this are what will appear on exam in concurrency. A given piece of code, okay, we'll be asking, okay, will this work? If yes, how? If not, like, why not?
I guess if someone maliciously writes code that unlocks the lock before they lock it, then they stop.
Okay, so one of the things here is what if the users don't use the lock and the unlock properly? What if they write code where they call unlock first and then call lock after the day, just unlock the lock and then immediately call it and stuff like that. But you can assume that people are fair and they will be using, you can assume that this is used in a proper way. Okay, don't need to worry about that. Just take a minute or so to think about this and then we'll just ask for the answers. If you have any questions, you can ask now.
Can you do that with the people?
Okay, then So you may just think about this. The reason why we are giving you time to think about this, because the problems that you will be given in the exams will be something that you wouldn't have seen already. It will be a very similar situation like this. Because this is the best way that we feel to learn concurrency. So one hint is definitely there is a problem. Okay? This this log doesn't work. You may start thinking about what is the problem.
Oh, that's because the scheduler can switch in the middle.
Okay, everyone figure out the problem?
I figure it must have something to do with the scheduler. Because the scheduler is evil.
Exactly, so the problem here, okay, the problem here is we just assumed that this whole function, just because it is named spin log, it is not like atomic. Does it make sense? So, which means that the whole function has like a bunch of instructions. One instruction is the checking of the condition, while condition. And another instruction is like a no op, which is just a semicolon. And another instruction, let's say, is like setting that log's value to one, okay? So, here, if you think about this, this is like thread one, and if this is thread two. Let's initially assume that the log initially was just zero, okay? It was an unlocked state, okay? At this point, let's assume thread one runs, it calls the log. When we call it spin log, inside thread one, we just did a condition like while, right? While, let's just assume, we are just checking this value of log, right? So if this is one, then you wait, but we were not, it was zero, so it can actually go and lock it, right? But at this time, our scheduler comes into place, okay? So here, what it does is like scheduler suddenly switches to thread two. There is a context switch here. It checked, let's assume it checked, this condition check is done. We just saw that the log is zero, so we are almost ready to acquire the log, set the log to one. But at that time, before we set the log to one, the context switch happened, and here, now thread two calls log. Thread 2 checks the condition, the same condition, while log is equals 1, log is still 0, no one updated the log, so thread 2 thinks it is still unlocked. Thread 2 goes ahead, skips this semicolon line, it just goes ahead with setting the log to 1, okay, sets the log to 1, but at this time again, now thread 1, thread 2 is in the critical section, another context switch happens, now this check was already done. This check was already done in thread one. So thread one is just resuming from wherever it left off. So now it's going to just come to the code that is outside the while loop, which is nothing but acquiring the log again, acquiring the log. So now both the threads have just locked it at the same time. So this is a race condition. Both are in the critical section. Both are racing to update the value. Does this make sense? So the whole idea here is like checking the condition of the while loop and updating the variable log is not atomic. There can be an interrupt in between the time we check and we update the value. Okay? Are there any questions in this? Because this is the fundamental way that we will be thinking about concurrent programs. Like, what are the different places a problem can occur? Like, how can our evil scheduler schedule things in, like, what to say, in a way that this doesn't work? So any questions with this? Yeah. Exactly. So even the single line of code where we had like just assign this one to this particular log, okay? Even that we should check, like we can check this particular thing, okay? So when you do a obj dump.
You can't see it.
Just doing obj dump of this particular thing. So here, spin lock, this is our old function. You can see here the while loop. The while loop spans across like so many lines. The compare, jump equals, move, like a bunch of instructions here belong to the while loop. Just a single line that we had here is like multiple lines in the assembly, and this is where the particular assignment. So the question was, okay, is the assignment of log equals one, okay? Is that single thing, is it atomic or not? Is that right? So based on this, we can easily see that that is not atomic because we are moving the contents of that particular location to a register, and then we are like moving one to that register. So from here, I think it's not atomic, but we can check.
So, yeah. I mean, it seems like the crux of the issue is that assembly is many lines. So no matter what, you're going to get interrupted in the middle of it. So you just like implement a real locking system, except like you say all interrupt and you say no one can interrupt, and then you need to, you know.
Yeah, exactly. So that was a very good insight. So since a single line of C code translates into multiple lines of assembly code, then how can we even like come up with some real world logs? How can we implement real world logs? And the answer is like one way is like if we have a mechanism to disable interrupts and re-enable them, like if we can disable interrupts, let's say at the top of the spin lock, okay? And if we can re-enable the interrupts at the end of the spin lock, if we have that particular facility, then definitely no interrupts can happen within this particular time. Okay, this is definitely one of the solutions, but what is the problem with the solution? Pardon? No, let's assume like we have like a function where you can just call disable interrupts, and we can call enable interrupts whenever we are implementing a log. So inside this, it is going to be inside our log, it's just going to be disable interrupts here and enable interrupts after this line. Yeah, only this will be running. Then it's okay. If we have those that facility, then this is going to like just run atomically, okay? And this is the only thing that will be running, and no other interrupts can actually like produce a context switch, okay? But the problem is the logs that we are implementing are like user level code, okay? So like user level, like pthreads.h is like a user level library, okay? And usually if someone, some person makes a mistake of like just forgetting to like re-enable the interrupts, then that bug just like halts your system completely, right? No other interrupt is going to be handled after that, and then no way the system can make progress. The timer interrupt is just, it will be just coming, but it will not even be coming, it will be just like disabled. And the operating system cannot even take back control from the user program, okay? So that is definitely one of the solutions that we can think of, but that's not going to work. And even that is problematic when we think about multiple CPUs. If there are multiple CPUs, if we disable interrupts on one CPU, that's not going to disable interrupts on the other CPUs. If the second thread runs on CPU 2, then it's just going to enter the critical section. OK, then what do we need right now?
Context switch should check the locks.
So context switch should check for locks. OK, so you're saying like before we context switch, we should just
the OS.
The OS should check, like how can it check for locks? So the main problem here is like we are just executing like some user level code or like some assembly instructions, and we want like certain instructions to be atomic, okay? And again, whenever we are struck with the problem, who comes to our rescue? The hardware, exactly. So the hardware, again, without the help of the hardware, we can't do like anything much after this point. So here, hardware provides special assembly instructions, okay? Where if we use that instruction, one for example, one of the instructions is called compare and swap, okay? Or test and set, that is an instruction, assembly instruction called test and set. And that assembly instruction, like, can test, I mean, check a particular value and update that particular value atomically. And we can, in turn, use instructions like that to actually create locks. We can use those assembly instructions to actually create our spin locks. Okay, that's going to be the next part of our class. So I think we can take a break right now. Before we go, any questions on this till now? Okay, so the next, the last part of the class, we're going to see like how do we use the help of the hardware, what is the help that the hardware gives us, and then how can we implement like working locks.
Separate bits.
So the first hardware primitive, okay, that we are going to see like at least four or five hardware primitives. We're not in, not everything in the same class, but at least today we'll see like one or two. Okay. So the first hardware primitive that we are going to see is called test and set. Just as of now, just start focusing just here, okay? Test and set. So what this primitive does, this is just a pseudo code. This is, whatever is given here is just a pseudo code of what this primitive is trying to do. But internally, like, it is actually the whole thing, whatever we are seeing here as a pseudo code, would be implemented as a single assembly instruction. Okay? So the first primitive is called test and set or atomic exchange. Okay? What it says is if you call that particular function called exchange, you can, first thing is it is guaranteed to be atomic. The whole function is guaranteed to be atomic because it is like the guarantee that the hardware gives you for that particular instruction. And here it takes in a log, which is just a pointer to an integer in this case, and then it gets a new value. All that it's doing is it just gets the value that was inside that log, the old value that is inside that log, and stores it in a variable called old, updates the log's value with the new value, okay? Updates the value of the log with the new value, and then just returns the old value. This is what test and set does. For example, let's just assume we have this lock variable here, okay? If this lock is, let's say, initially zero, okay? All it's trying to do is, if you call this particular function, like exchange, with the log, okay, address of that log variable, and if you give a new value of 1, it just takes this value of 0, stores it inside that old, gets this new value, updates it to 1, okay, and then just immediately returns you the old value. So the return value here was 0. Would return you 0. That's all it does. this is just a hardware primitive. By that, what we mean is internally, like with the code, it looks something like this. So now think of this XCNG or the exchange that we have here. This function is just name of a function, okay? This function takes in a pointer to an unsigned integer, and it also takes in a new value. But here within the C code, we are actually writing some assembly code. ASM here stands for assembly code. Don't worry about understanding this assembly code, but this is how locks are actually implemented in the real world. So this is like one implementation of a lock. Here, this instruction that we have here, XCHG, okay? It just stands for atomic exchange. That L at the end just means the locked version of the exchange instruction. Exchange, there is another instruction in x86 called just XCHG, which is just exchange instruction, which just like you give a value, it stores that value in that particular location and returns you the old value. That's all it does. But this XCHG at the, with the L at the end just stands for atomic exchange, okay? And we really don't need to understand how or what is happening here. This is like, but if you're interested, we can like, you feel free to like go through it and trying to understand each and every directive that is there. Each and everything means something like M, A, all those things. But here you can assume that we just have used this particular atomic exchange instruction that the hardware provides, and we have written a function called XCHG, okay? And now you can think like some library, like a pthread library, already provides you this XCHG function, something like this, okay? This is like at the level of the library writers, okay? We're just showing you here. But now, our task is like, if we are going to, again, as a library writer, or if we are going to implement our own spin lock, how can we use this exchange, okay? This particular thing, if this is confusing here, in the sense, we can also, because both are XCHG, you can also just name it something different, just like test and set. Okay? Of course, both test and set and exchange just means the same thing. So now, how can we use this particular function called test and set, okay, to actually implement a working spin lock? By that here we mean, can we write some code here to make sure that if we call test and set, the hardware gives us the guarantee that this whole thing is going to happen atomically, in the sense whatever value that we pass in as a new value is going to be updated in that location called ADDR, and the old value in that location is going to be returned to us. This whole thing is going to happen atomically. With this atomic instruction, can we build a working spin lock on top of them? That is the idea here. Okay? So, definitely we are going to call this test and set, okay, with some parameters. And the parameter is, first thing is going to be the lock that we get here, okay? And it's already a pointer, so you can just pass in the pointer directly. And your task is, what is this value? What is the new value that you should give here, okay, for this particular thing? Maybe like I can write you like, just like show you what we're trying to expect here, okay? So here we are just going to use this test and set to build a lock, right? So we are going to use the test and set in a way that only if this returns, okay? If this returns, then we will enter the critical section, okay? If this line returns, then we are going to enter the critical section. Then how can we make sure that this particular, when we are calling test and set, we should make sure that we check for some value, okay, for some condition, we check for some condition, and that condition is nothing but if the lock is already held, right? The condition that we are going to check is the lock already held? How can we check that? So here we are trying to update this value of x. I'll just have it as x, okay? Let's assume. If this lock is already held, then let's assume if we start with the if condition, okay? If this lock is already held, then what should we do? We should just spin, right? But to make that happen, we should check this condition again, by spinning, if you just have a semicolon here, this is not going to work because it just checks the condition once, okay, and then it just enters the critical section. But we want to check it again and again. So as we saw previously, we are just going to have a while loop here, just going to check this condition. This x, I'm not writing it right now, but we're just going to check something like this. So now it's your task to figure out what should be the values of x and y, so that this means that this test and set, we are going to just keep on spinning if the lock is already held. And we should come out of that loop if the lock is free. Does it make sense? This is how we are going to implement a lock right now. And I just, for this, because this is the first thing, I'm just like writing it down here as it is. Like, okay, while we are testing and setting, while we're checking that particular atomic function called test and set, we are going to pass in a value called x, and then we are going to check the return value from that particular call. And if that is something else, which is y, we are just going to keep on looping, else we are going to like enter the critical section. Maybe this thing I can just work out with you guys. So here, if you think about it, okay, here, spin lock is trying to set a lock, right? When we're trying to set a lock, we should first be sure which value stands for what. Till now, at least we have assumed that. Okay, till now we have assumed that 0 stands for, we should be very clear about this, okay? So initially, let's maybe have like a comment here, because this is a mutex that we are using. This integer variable is a mutex. So 0, again, is not held. Okay, 1, again, just means the lock is held. Okay, this is the case. 0 means this lock is not held. 1 means the lock is held. Here, we're trying to lock it. So the x is going to be nothing but 1, because we are trying to set a value of 1 to the lock. Okay, x is just going to be 1. We are trying to set the lock. But what does test and set return? It returns the previous value that we already have in that lock. So if that lock was already like acquired by some other thread, then it's going to return you 1. Okay, so the y is also just going to be 1, which means I'm trying to set this lock, the test set and lock, lock comma 1 just means I'm trying to set this lock. At the same time, I'm also checking the return value from that particular atomic function, which is 1, which means that the lock is already held by some other thread, and so I just spin. Okay? But at a point, that lock is going to be released. After some point, that lock is going to be released. At that time, this test and set, lock comma 1, is going to return 0. Because that value would have been made to 0 by some other thread, right? But it doesn't happen automatically, so we should have implemented this unlock code properly. So in this unlock code, all we should do is just say, use the same thing, test and set lock comma 0. That's all we should do here. Because in the unlock, we are not going to worry about any conditions. All we have to do is just go and set that value to 0, and then you are done, right? But locking is not so easy, in the sense. You have to check if the lock is already held. If so, keep on spinning, else enter the critical section. So now when some thread releases the lock, it's going to call the spin unlock. And at the time, the value of the lock is going to be 0. So we again go back when we check that particular condition in, like say thread 2, test and set lock comma 1, till now it was getting the return value of 1, but suddenly now it's going to get a return value of 0. And so the while condition fails, we come out of the while loop, and when we come out of the while loop, it means we just enter the critical section. Because this particular function, spin lock, is just called on top of the critical, just before the critical section. We lock the critical section. Does it make sense?
So we're allowed to assume that the condition check happens in a single assembly instruction as well for the while loop? Like, is it possible to have the assembly do stick the results of test and set on as one command and then do the comparison as a second command? It would just be a false positive, so it's not the end of the world. But
So
you don't need to, though.
We can only assume that the value that is returned by test and sit, or like test and sit, is atomic. We can't assume that the comparisons are atomic.
Okay.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, like you just told, it's just like.
Because the return value you get is whatever it was when you updated it. So regardless, if the context switch happens, when it comes back, it'll still have the appropriate value to do the comparison. That makes sense.
We'd have to, conceivably, when it comes back as a 1, and then before you do the comparison, it got switched to a 0, you then have to wait until the next loop.
It's in the stack, so nothing else has access to that. So we don't have to worry about the concurrency.
So you mean like... So this particular spin lock will be called by each thread by itself, right? So yeah, as you just told, it will be like whatever value we are getting there will be like a local to the stack of that particular thread. I don't think we need to worry about that.
And you might end up waiting like an extra trip or two through the library, right?
Yeah, that's just what I was thinking. It's not...
We wouldn't wait for the other while.
I'm so confused.
So this is, if you just go and try this, this is a working like lock implementation. And so now the way that we're going to proceed is very similar in the sense we have like similar primitives, multiple primitives like this. How can, if given a primitive, how can you build a lock on top of the primitive? That's going to be the idea, okay? So we will here, we will usually see like some 4 to 5 primitives, and usually the way we test this, like give you a new primitive and see if you can build a lock using that new primitive. So the way is just to find out if you can understand how those primitives work and can you build a lock on top of that. So for example, let's now just try the second one, which is the compare and swap. Okay. So this is another primitive called compare and swap. And in this primitive, again, you have a lock, which is this pointer, and then you have expected value and then a new value. You pass in 2 values to this primitive, and you do something inside that. Just check, like, just try reading what we are doing inside that. And using these, can you write the code for spin lock and spin unlock? That's the task. Okay, you can take like some 2 to 3 minutes.
Just to make sure, like what you asked, do you mean like a thread checks that value, okay, when it calls that it is like currently 1, and then when it checks the next time, before it actually checks the value of 0, gets the value to some other thread, just got that value back or something like that?
Yeah, I'm just quibbling for if the value of the lock changes in between when you run the exchange. And when you actually check it, then conceivably you'd have to loop around any extra time before you realize, hey, it's actually unlocked.
Yes, that can happen. So that just means like there are multiple threads. Some threads can just like keep on checking that value. It will never see a value of 0. It will be starving. Mm-hmm. Basically, that can happen.
I was expecting this to be more like the second primitive, where it actually does the comparison and the swap in the same instruction. But I think that makes a bit more sense to me.
Yeah, but what you just told can happen. So some threads can even before it sees the actual unlocked value, some other threads can see that and enter the critical section, and so these threads will be starting for some time.
Is there something that actually happens? I guess you could build a giant structure on top of it to look for.
Exactly, we are going to go look at those like in future classes. Okay. Exactly. So because this block is definitely not fair to all the threads.
Okay.
just the C stuff. How would you use it?
Oh, for walking around.
Those are atomic.
Oh, is it using the star walk thing?
It's magic stuff behind me. But what purpose does this work to?
But it's not actually showing up somewhere like a dozen. He's not saying fucking.
He's just being more thorough.
Let's look at this, okay? So here we have this compare and swap. So what it is trying to do is like gets a pointer to the lock and has expected value and a new value. So this is what we are expecting the value to be, and this is the new value that we are trying to set to the lock. So here what it returns is just the actual value that was inside that particular lock. Okay, and then it actually, in the if condition, it checks if these two values, the expected and the actual value, if they are equal, then you update the thing, okay? But if they are not, then just don't update it. Just like return the previous value. That's all it's trying to do. So using this, how can we build a lock? Let's assume we have the core for spin lock here. So inside this, if you're going to use this compare and swap, you just write something like while. Just writing CAS for compare and swap, okay? While compare and swap. If you're going to build a lock in the same thing, again, 0 is not held and 1 is held. So the thing that we are expecting is to be 0. That first you should pass in the lock here. Lock. And then you're expecting the lock to be 0, which is in the unlocked state. And then you're trying to set the value of 1. And if what is the condition that you want to like spin? The condition that you want to spin is the lock was already held. It's nothing but, in this case, it's just going to be 1. Does it make sense? So this is going to be the code for spin lock. For locking, and then for spin unlock. So now what should be here? Spin unlock, if you are using compare and swap, you can use it like compare and swap of the lock, and the value that you are expecting it to be is 1, because only when it is locked, you are trying to like unlock it, and then the new value that you are going to set is 0, which is actually unlocking that particular lock. Okay, you can do this, but in this simple example, where we saw here, okay, what we saw here, if assume we have access to that compare and swap thing, and the mutex that we have here is just a simple integer that we are accessing. Okay, in this case, if you want to avoid that extra performance overhead of calling a function here, simply you can just say, instead of this, you can just comment this out, and you can just simply say star log, just the value inside that variable, to be 0. This also should work. Does it make sense? All you're trying to do here is just set that value to 0, but if you want to use compare and swap, you can use compare and swap in both spin lock and spin unlock, but it is really not required to use those primitives in the spin unlock if you have access to that particular, which is like a simple integer variable. You can directly just access it and set that value to be 0. That's all we're trying to do here. Okay, so now before we proceed to any, like the, even the third lock, one thing that we want, we'll be doing continuously in locks is like, analyze the locks, okay? How do we even know if some lock is good or not, okay? We will be measuring the lock in like three axes. First thing is correctness. Okay, first you should make sure if you're building a lock, is it correct or not, okay? Second is fairness. And the third thing is performance. Now let's just evaluate the two logs that we just saw in today's class along these three axes. So the first thing is exchange, atomic exchange or test and set. Second thing that we just saw is like compare and swap. Okay. First, let's just talk about correctness. So whenever we talk about correctness, we are just trying to find out, can any two threads acquire the lock at the same time? Okay. As we just saw, like, since these are hardware primitives, then hardware guarantees us that these things happen in an atomic way. And for both these things, we can be sure that the correctness is guaranteed, okay? That this, these are like correct locks. So if you don't believe it, whatever we just, the code that we just wrote now, you can try executing it on your own and see if the variable is updated like in the correct way, okay? To see if that lock really works. And then the next axis that we measure all the logs is usually called fairness. What do we mean by fairness here is, if there are 100 threads that are concurrently trying to acquire a critical section, okay? Can threads starve? Can some threads starve in this case? Okay, let's first just take the example of test and set, okay? It's just a spin lock, okay? It's checking some condition. If it is not true, if it is true, we are just spinning. We're just checking the condition again and again. And if there are 100 threads, it is easily possible that whenever a particular thread is checking the condition, it is always like true, which means like the, for a particular thread, the lock seems to be acquired by some other thread always. Because we really don't have any order in which we like give the locks to all these threads, right? It just like happens in a random way in which the scheduler decides, right? Scheduler may decide to, so if there are 100 threads and if the first thread just releases the lock, whichever thread runs next is the luckiest thread, right? Because that's going to see this thing change, the unlock thing, and then it's just going to acquire the lock. So there is no way that we can say that we have fairness in the first lock, in this exchange type of lock, because threads can easily starve in this case. But can, is fairness guaranteed in compare and swap? No. Again, if you can check the thing, it's just again, we are just getting two values and then we are returning the old value and then checking the things. Oh, it just depends on whichever thread just enters or checks, calls this particular compare and swap immediately after the thread, some thread releases it. So again, it's just by chance or it's just completely dependent on the scheduler. So there is no way that this is also fair. So this is also not fair, okay? Compare and swap. Again, any thread can enter the critical section, which means that some threads can starve without even entering the critical section once, okay? And the last axis that we will be measuring is like the performance. Here, by performance, we mean, okay, there are like 100 threads and each thread, let's assume, has like a time slice. This is the time slice for thread 1. This is the time slice for thread 2. Let's just assume 3 threads as of now, okay? If this is the thread that has the lock and these two threads are waiting for the same lock, then whenever these two threads are executed on the CPU, okay, for the entire time slice, if it is a round robin scheduling algorithm, for the entire time slice, all that these threads are going to do is just check that particular condition, then do a no op, which is a semicolon, do nothing, then just go back and check that particular condition, just keep on checking that particular condition, which is spinning. All these threads are going to do is just spin. And by doing that, they are just wasting the particular time slice on that CPU. Does it make sense? And if, let's just assume we have like 1000 threads or 100 threads, and if first thread has the lock, then first thread gets the lock and enters the critical section, but it is not yet done, okay? It is somewhere in the critical section. Now a context switch happens, thread 2 comes in, wastes its entire time slice just by checking it, thread 3 comes in, then till thread 99, thread 100 comes in, all this time is like wasted on the CPU. Is that right? We're just wasting this time completely on the CPU. And so And this just happens in every spin lock. Whenever we have a spin lock, this is what is going to happen. And so these two locks, with respect to performance, are not so good.
Is it possible to teach the scheduler about locks so that it doesn't try to schedule things that can't
run? I don't think so. So the question is it possible to like teach the scheduler about locks so that it doesn't like run things unnecessarily? In a sense, teach in a sense, for example, we can inform the scheduler. What is the solution here? So what can we avoid? So this problem of performance, how can we avoid all the remaining 99 threads to waste the, not to waste the particular time slice?
Change the status to waiting?
Pardon?
Change the status to waiting somehow?
So like it's, exactly, it's just like yielding. It's just, we, if you remember, we saw something called yield, which just puts the process back into the ready queue again, but just yields the CPU. You remember that? So instead of actually spinning, we're going to look at locks, much more interesting locks in the next few, in the next class. And so there we'll see like the best way to avoid this spin waiting is instead of just waiting, just call yield. We're not going to waste the entire time slice. Instead, the only amount of time that is wasted is the context switch time. Okay? Just waste the context switch time and then you immediately yield the CPU. But again, that also will be a problem because like, think about it, that particular context switch time is going to be wasted for all the 99 threads. Context switch, just to go and yield again. Okay, so all these problems we'll be like handling in the next class. I think it's time. If you have any questions, we have like 1 more minute. If you have any questions about whatever we just discussed. And these are the 3 axes we are going to like measure all the locks that we are going to learn, okay? And almost most of the next class is going to be completely on locks, but much more like useful and complicated locks. Okay. So, any questions about the exam? If you have any questions about the exam or anything in general, just come talk with me after the lecture. Thank you.